Man, what a great way to celebrate. I'm so glad that you're here. I forgot to introduce myself earlier. My name is Dan. I'm a teaching pastor here. And so if you are new, if I haven't got a chance to meet you yet, I would love to. After the service, I'll be hanging out at the Welcome Center, and I'd love to shake hands with you and say thanks for being here personally. We're going to be looking at a passage of Scripture today. So if you got a Bible, I want you to open it up to John chapter 20. Shouldn't be too hard to find. It's in the New Testament. It's the fourth gospel. So if you find the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, you'll get to John. And if you flip to the end of that, we're going to be in John chapter 20 in just a few minutes. As you turn there, you know, one thing I love about Easter is it's not hard to come up with a topic to talk about. It's already kind of pre-prescribed for us. And so, as I said earlier, I mean, all around the globe today, people are kind of talking about some angle on the same thing, and that's the resurrection. And the reason for that is if there's no resurrection, we don't have a faith. There's no reason for us to gather, group together. There's no reason to sing these songs. There's no reason for you to get dressed up and go buy an Easter dress or a new tie for some of you. I've never seen wear a tie before, and some of you wearing a tie. I don't know what that's about, but that's a tradition. That's cool. There'd be no reason to do that if the resurrection didn't take place. And so it's not hard on that aspect. But one thing that is kind of weird about Easter, if you're, and put you in my shoes for a second, there's a lot of pressure on Easter for some reason. Pastors will tell you if you kind of get in a conversation with them that Easter and holidays are some of the most pressure-packed times to do what we do because there's some underlying tension to say, hey, you've got to bring your A game. You know, it's kind of like the playoffs. If you're a sports person, you know, or something like that, you think, well, this is the day. Don't mess this one up. If there's ever a chance to mess something up, don't do it on this day. And so there's kind of this underlying tension or pressure, if you're in my position, to make sure that you do adequate justice to the resurrection. And through the years, you know, I've struggled with that personally. I've always kind of like, man, I gotta have a new angle. I gotta come up with something new that people haven't thought before, kind of blow their minds or something like that. But as I've gone through those years, one thing that God has continually confirmed to me is that there actually is no pressure. Matter of fact, all the pressure has already been taken care of because the battle is already won. That the power is not in my ability to communicate to you, nor is it in your ability to perform. The truth of the gospel, the power of the resurrection, says definitively that the resurrection brings power and it can change lives in and of itself. And so today what I want to simply do to you, do for you is, for some of you, perhaps the first time to give you a fresh look at the resurrection. For some of us, it may be a reminder about why we do what we do. And for some of you that are kind of immersed and familiar with it, but actually it hasn't had power in your life yet, my prayer has been that today would be the moment that you, maybe even unwittingly or unexpectedly, you came for a tradition or whatever, that you would encounter the resurrected Christ today and that it would be a life-changing event for you, even if you didn't expect it. And so toward that end, what I would like to ask you to do is answer a question for me. All right, you don't have to answer it out loud, but I want to ask you a question of every single person in the room, because today is all about the resurrection. Today is all about belief. And I want you to just kind of symbolically, if you will, or through your mind, to draw a circle around yourself. And the reason I want to do that is some of you came with family, some of you came with friends, some of you are here with a spouse that comes to church, but you don't. Some of you are here, the kids brought you or the parents brought you or whatever it is, or maybe you're with a girlfriend or a boyfriend and that's the only reason you came, you know, and that's cool too. We don't care why you're here. We're just glad you're here. But every single person in the room, first time guest, been here forever, I want you to draw symbolically a circle around you. And I want to ask you a question, just you and you alone, not who you're sitting next to. I want to ask you the question, do you really believe in the resurrection? Do you believe it? Do you really believe it? Now, what I'm not asking you is, do you have a familiarity with it? I'm not asking you, could you recite the story that even if you just picked up from the songs that there was a man named Jesus, he died on a cross, a stone was rolled away. It's fresh in your mind, we just sang about it. Could you tell the story? I'm asking you, do you actually believe the story? And as we go through this passage today, my hope is that you will be able to find an answer of where you stand. Because it makes no sense to sing songs about it. It makes no sense to gather together if you personally, inside that circle, have not answered the question for you, yourself, whether the physical reality of the resurrection has become a personal reality to you. Now, all the gospel writers tell the story. They all lead up to this climax. But in John chapter 20, John actually lands on what is his thesis statement for everything he's talked about in sharing the story with Jesus. And it's all about belief. Matter of fact, if you skim down to verse 30 in John chapter 20, you're going to find it. This is what Scripture says. This is John talking, the writer, the author of the book, the story of the Gospel of John. He says, Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not recorded in this book. Basically, what he says is, hey, listen, Jesus did a whole lot of stuff, and I don't know if you've ever asked the question, I've asked it, is like, why do we only know this about Jesus? There's a lot of questions. I mean, all the Gospels kind of leave out big chunks of time. Jesus didn't start his earthly ministry until he was in his 30s, and so you get a big gap even in the early Gospels that tell the birth narrative. But in John's Gospel, I don't know if you realize this or not, but he actually only shares 20 or 21 days of Jesus' life. He doesn't really talk that much about the early years, and I've always got questions about why do we only get what we've got. I want to know more about this Jesus. If he's supposed to be the centerpiece of all history, then I want to know everything that I can know about him. John corroborates that. He says that, hey, man, if I could share with you everything about Jesus, I mean, there could not be enough libraries for me to tell you about everything he's done. I could write on and on and on. I could give you all the backstory. I could give you all the details, all the highs and the lows, all the angles. Matter of fact, there's so much to say about this God. But inside that, he says that out of all those things that I could tell you about Jesus, in verse 31, he says, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. He says, I want to be real upfront with you about my motive, about what I've shared about these last 20, 21 days of Jesus' life. It's one thing. I want you to believe. I've written everything. I've edited it. I've culled out what I think is not necessarily as important. And I want to share with you the things that I think that are of premier importance for you, because my motive, I just being up front with you, my motive is what I asked of you earlier. Do you really believe? And so John didn't want to write random words. He's not writing random words. He's not saying random facts, factoids about who this Jesus revolutionary leader, teacher, supposed to be God is. He says, no, I'm writing these things for one motive and one motive alone. I want you to believe. I want you to believe what I believe after seeing what I've seen. And so I want to ask you a second question based on John's motive. If the question is, do you really believe the resurrection? And if John's motive is, I want to share these things so that you may believe that he's the Messiah, the Son of God, my question to you is simply this, or what are these things? What are these things? What are the things that John thought were so important that could actually bring power to your life and could answer the question for you where you stand with this God? Whether you really believe or you don't. Maybe you're out there and you don't know where you stand. Maybe you thought you did at one time, but you don't know now. Maybe it's a foregone, you know, it's back there in the past somewhere when you were a kid or you were a teenager and you've kind of wandered and strayed. And at one time you knew, but now you don't know. I mean, you've been through some stuff. Maybe some of you, you never really considered Jesus. I mean, you're fine with God in general, right? You're fine with a higher power. You understand that. There's got to be some definition or reason for all this. But you've never really wrestled and dealt with Jesus. For some of you, you are so familiar with him that he's not even real to you anymore. He's just something you do. He's in the rhythm of your life. He's just part of the week, part of the day. But you've never really stopped and considered whether you actually believe, belief being, he's become such a personal reality to me that he filters down into all the facets of my life. So the question is really simple. What are these things? What are these things that can answer all those questions? Well, to get into the story, you got to go back up to the top. And when you get to verse 1, he provides the backdrop for belief for us. This is what he says. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark. Now, I'll stop there because this is something that's probably counterintuitive to a lot of us, especially in the South. The story of belief begins in the dark. John has this running motif throughout the gospel. He uses these pictures, these symbols. And one of his favorite symbols throughout the whole gospel, if you read through it from beginning to end, you're going to pick up on it. There's light and dark. There's interplay of the light entering the world in John chapter 1. You get it in all the dialogue. You've got symbolism of fire and light and all these different kinds of things in darkness. And so what this tells us is that when John ends and he says, I want to write these things, the things that he's writing about, they begin in darkness. We think that the backdrop for faith, for most of us, this is what we think. We think the backdrop for faith is church services. We think it's choirs. We think it's bands. We think it's small groups, Sunday school. We think it's preachers like me. We think it's steeples or a modern facility. We think it's getting yourself better. That's the backdrop for belief. But I think John's very intentional to set really clearly on the very beginning is that all the backdrop for belief always begins in the same place. Every belief begins in the dark. Matter of fact, there's not a story of belief that begins in the light. Everything begins in the dark. And so the story of the resurrection doesn't begin in the light. It begins in the dark. And so he sets the backdrop, the stage for us to help us to understand that if you're an unbeliever in the room, you're in the dark right now. It's okay because that's where everybody starts. As the story picks up momentum, though, you begin to see the first instance of the awareness that something's happened. Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and she saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. I want to introduce you to something that's going to hold everything together as we go through the passage today. It's the word saw. If you're the type of person that likes to write in your Bible or underline things or make notes, I want to kind of tell you on the front end, as we go through the passage, if you will underline or highlight every time you see the word saw or seen, John's trying to help us understand that while the backdrop for belief is darkness and unbelief, that he's trying to give us a pattern of sorts to help us understand how faith and how belief actually takes place in your life. He kind of diagnoses for us through a narrative. He says, I want you to see in the lives of individuals these things, how this takes place. And so he always uses the word saw or seen. He wants us to help us to understand how faith can come, how belief can come in our life. She sees the stones rolled away. And what's interesting about it is that this person that has been with Jesus, Mary Magdalene, if you don't know much about her, she was somebody that had a previous encounter with Jesus. She didn't come out of nowhere. She had a lot of a relationship with Jesus. Jesus finds her. She was pretty much prescribed as a demoniac in Scripture. Most believe her to have been a prostitute. She lived in a male-dominant culture, and she was a female, and she was a prostitute at that. And so she just kept going farther and farther down on the social structure of the list. She was poor. She had no power. She met Jesus, and Jesus radically transformed her life, changed her identity, made her a new person. And so she had a deep relationship with Jesus. That relationship that was instigated by Jesus began to build as relationships do. And she heard Jesus talk about the future. She heard his teachings. She talked about everything that he promised to do, that he was going to be crucified, that he was going to be placed in a tomb. He used a lot of symbolic language. He talked about the fact that they would tear the temple down, talking about himself, and he would raise it back up in 3 days. She heard all these things. But when she got to the tomb in the darkness that day, what she saw, she did not receive. She was not ready to receive what it was that she was seeing. And so when she saw the stone, she, though seeing it, she did not have perception. She did not have discernment. She did not understand what was happening. She believed something totally different. She didn't believe in the resurrection. So the people that were even closest to Jesus, the most familiar with him, yet did not believe. And so John tells a story and he introduces to us, basically he's going to introduce three scenes. This is the first. Where the people that first encountered the resurrection all began in unbelief. So much so was her unbelief, you'd have to say, well, what did she think? Well, Scripture tells us what she thought. She came running to Simon Peter and the other disciples, and then the one Jesus loved, and said, they've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him. The only logical landing she could come to in this whole process was that somebody had to steal his body. She did not believe the resurrection. She didn't believe it was physically possible. If people think a lot of times, well, people of faith, they're just kind of, they're not as smart as everybody else. I mean, these people, early stages, they must have been predisposed to believe this. Actually, Jews were not predisposed to believe in the resurrection. Some believed in a bodily resurrection, but they thought it was at the end of everything. They didn't believe that the Messiah was going to come and be resurrected. And so they didn't come into this predisposed to belief. It was going to take some convincing, and for her, she stood in the moment, and the only thing that she could come up with was that someone has taken the body. That's the only logical idea that she could fathom for what she saw. She saw, but she didn't yet believe. So she goes to the disciples. She says, hey, something's going on. I need you guys to get involved. So she goes to Simon Peter, the one that Jesus loved. If you fast forward the story, she goes to tell them, and they begin to run to the tomb. And John's the one telling the story. Most believe he refers to himself in third person, which is really annoying. If you know anybody that does that, he says he's the one that Jesus loved. And he makes sure to give you the little detail that when they begin to run to the tomb, that he outruns Peter. I don't know what that was about, but he's like, hey, I just want you to know I'm faster than everybody else. And so he gets to the tomb, and when he gets to the tomb, he does what a Jew would typically do. He peeks in. Jews would not go in and be close to a dead body. It would render them ceremonially unclean, all right? And plus, even if you don't have a religious belief about it, who's going to run into a tomb, right? I'm not running into that tomb. Several reasons. One, that's kind of scary. It's kind of weird. And it probably smells really bad. Let's just be honest. And so he stops logically at the end of, or the beginning of the tomb, and he just peeks in, and what he sees in there is the absence of the body, but the presence of the wrappings of the body. And then over on the side, he sees the head wrapping, the one that was the final wrapping on Jesus' head, and he sees it neatly folded off to the side by itself, as if to say, I don't need this anymore, right? And so he's standing there, but he's not alone. Remember, Peter starts running up behind him down in verse 6. Simon Peter comes along behind him, and he goes straight into the tomb because that's what Peter does. He's like, you know, I'm not stopping, right? No pause, anything like that. Impetuous, runs in. He sees the strips of linen. There's the word saw again. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. He sees the same thing that John sees. He's looking at it, and this is what happens next. The cloth is still lying there in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first, that's John, also went inside. Probably went like this. It probably said, Peter's probably said, dude, you got to get in here. You got to see this. And John's probably like, I don't know if I want to get in there. I'm not sure about that. I don't know how the dialogue went, but finally he goes in and he saw and he believed. The word saw in the passage, you've got a normal word for saw. It just means what you would see, like, I saw that. But the word saw that Peter used, or is used to describe Peter, is a word that we get the word theorize from or scrutinize. It means to really begin to think, hypothesize, scrutinize. What could have possibly happened? What's going on here? And just as Mary was not predisposed to believe, the disciples were not predisposed to believe. Remember what happened at the cross? They all ran. Why did they run? It's because it was over. The guy had made the promises, the guy that said, follow me, the guy that had walked on water, the guy that had fed 5,000, changed water into wine, could not save himself. And who follows a dead leader? They went back to their lives. They went back to fishing. They went back to being a doctor. They cowered in the wake of the crucifixion. They did not know what to do. And so this broke their understanding of the world. God steps in through the resurrection. And what you see is the light beginning to grow through the passage. What started out in darkness progressively gets more and more bright, just like the sunrise. And as the sun comes up on Easter, you see that it begins to illuminate the darkness in Mary Magdalene's life and now the disciples' life. But they weren't quite ready to believe fully yet. Matter of fact, they run out. They're going to do and they'll tell the other disciples. But if you follow down into verse 11, you get to see what her response was. Mary stood outside the tomb crying. Why is she crying? Because it's over. And as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels, white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. There it is again. See, look, seen. As she stands there, you wonder, what is she thinking? She missed the significance of the stone. Now she's seeing angels, and she misses the significance of the angels. And the question in that moment, as she looks in, she still thinks someone is taking the body. And she's sitting there crying. Now, the question is, why is she crying? Well, why does she not understand? How could you look at a stone be rolled away? How could you look at angels inside the tomb and not say, maybe let's put the pieces together and let's figure out, this guy was resurrected. Why did she not yet believe? It's because it's the same reason that a lot of you don't believe in the room. See, when you're in a spot of great loss and grief, have you ever been there? I've been there. I lost my father. I've lost good friends. I've done funerals for babies and families that I love. I've been in moments when I've either been the family or been with the family, and the grief and the mourning was so thick, it was like a cloud that you couldn't see out of, and it felt as if you couldn't go on one more second, or if you could, you didn't want to. And she's in this cloud, the cloud of her loss and the cloud of her mourning, and that's the way it is for a lot of us. The reason that a lot of us are not ready to fully believe in the resurrection is not because of the physical validity of it. It's because all we can see is the cloud of our personal experience, the cloud of our understanding, the cloud of our grief. Because when you're in that moment, it feels like you can't see out of it. That's where she is. For some of us, it starts out personally. For some of us, we look around and we say, God, I look around and I see the suffering in the world. I mean, you might have had a discussion like that or might have thought that. You look at the atrocities that are committed against people that seem to be innocent from your perspective, and you wonder, how could this God exist? How could Jesus be real? And what you look at Jesus through is the lens of your understanding based on your grief, based on your loss, and it prohibits you from truly trusting Jesus. That's where she is in the moment. And into that moment, she's asked a probing question that God, I think, would ask you if that's you. Woman, why are you crying? I might change it and say, man, why are you crying? But same question. Now, if you're the one hearing that, you don't do this if you're a pastor or that you're visiting a mourning family. You don't go, hey, man, why are you crying? Like, that would be insulting. That'd be rude. I don't say that when I visit a funeral home. I don't say that when I visit a family after they get the news of loss. I don't say that. Why? It's insulting if someone's died. But they're asking the question to try to reveal to her that the reason for her tears are not actual reasons, that she has misunderstood the scenario, that the physical reality of the resurrection hasn't truly been received yet, because all that's dictating her response is a moment of great loss for her. They're trying to snap her out of it. And so at this moment, not only did they ask the question, but something else dramatic happens in verse 14. Watch what happens next. At this, she turns around and she saw Jesus standing there. See the progression? She saw the stone, didn't believe. Saw the angels, didn't believe. She sees Jesus and you think, now's the time. But she still doesn't believe. Some of you have seen Jesus in your life. You've seen Jesus in Scripture, but because of your grief, because of your mourning, it's created such an obstacle for you that you can't even see Jesus when he's right in front of you. And while he's standing in front of her, she did not realize that it was him. And so he doesn't leave and say, I can't believe you don't believe, Mary. I can't believe it. After everything I've done, stone, angels, I've sent you everything, linens, I've sent you everything. I spent all that time with you, yet you still don't believe. And instead, he leans in. And in verse 15, this is what he says. He asked her, woman, why are you crying? Same question, kind of insulting. Who is it you're looking for? He acts dumb. Jesus is funny. Thinking he was the gardener, she said, sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've put him, and I will go get him. She's in a hysterical moment. She's scrambling for answers, and there's no answers to be found. She feels completely alone. The disciples did their business. They ran away, and now she's left alone in her grief. She's so hysterical. She's seen everything that she needs to see, you would think, to believe. She even sees Jesus, but she doesn't recognize who it is when he's standing right in front of her. And into that hysteria, into the cloud of grief, Jesus speaks. And this is what he says. He simply says to her, Mary. Mary. And I think this is what God does in his grace to us. In our hysteria, in our loss, in our grief, no matter how thick it is and how great the obstacle seems to you to actually believe in the resurrected Jesus, to put your faith and trust in him, he simply wants to say your name to you. That's a big deal. Why? Because he's the one that created you. He's the one that names you. He's the one that created your identity. And so when he says her name, it was like the light went on for her. This is the sensitivity of Jesus. this is not the Jesus that you would expect to say, forget you, you should have believed already. This is the one in insensitivity, no matter what you've been through today, wants to simply say your name. John, Dan, my wife, Veronica, my friends, Tyler, my friends, Jay, all around the room today, God wants to speak your name. And there's comfort in that moment. How do we know it was comfortable for her? Because in that moment, she holds on to Jesus. She recognizes him for who he was. Why? Because he spoke her name. God is calling some of you out. He's calling your name out today, out of the cloud of your grief. He's saying, hey, come to me. I'm resurrected. Believe in me. Because when you believe in the resurrection, that means that in your side of your greatest loss, in contrast to your greatest loss, there is hope. He took her greatest loss, and by saying her name, he pulled her out of the loss, and he said, there is eternal hope for your worst situation. The thing that you don't think you can get over, the thing that you think no one will ever forget, that you can't wash out of your mind, he calls you out of that, and he gives you hope based on the physical reality of his resurrection. What happens to her? What are these things that John's saying? The first scene is simply this. The physical reality for Mary became a personal reality for her as she clings to Jesus. Jesus says, hey, the story's not over yet. Don't just sit here and hold on to me because I'm not ascended to my Father yet. I'm not finished. She thought this was the end of it, right? The end was there. Now this is the end. This is all she'd hoped for. And he says, I'm not done yet. He said, I want you to go back and tell the others. And so if you drop down to verse 18, Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news. She tells them. And she tells them what she's seen. I have seen the Lord. She told them that he had said these things to her. She told them the whole story. Tells them the whole story about everything that was going on. And what's interesting is that where she finds them gives us a next scene of belief. I mean, when you get to the next verse, she's sharing with them, telling them all these things, but on that evening of the first day of the week when the disciples were together, the doors were locked for fear of the Jewish leaders. Where are they? They must have been Baptists because they're having a little committee meeting, right? I mean, I don't know what's going on in the world, but Peter and John, they've come back and told her now. Mary's come and told them, and where she finds them is up locked in a room for fear of the Jewish leaders. Now, why would they be so afraid? The reason they're afraid is really simple. It's because word had gotten out already about the body not being in the tomb. And much like Mary thought that someone had stole the body, the Jewish leaders also believed that. And what they believed was that the disciples, wanting to perpetuate a myth of their revolutionary leader, had gone in, somehow concocted a plan of their own, taken the body out, which is ridiculous to me because they left the linens there. Like, if I'm going to steal a dead body, I'm stopping by Walmart or Lowe's and getting a tarp, right? I'm not unwrapping that thing and putting him on my shoulder. I'm not pulling him out. I mean, despite the smell, I'm not touching that after 3 days. That's not me, all right? I'm not that guy. But they believe that the disciples had taken the body. Now, if you're one of the disciples, what would you do in a moment like that? You'd think, well, they've already crucified Jesus. They already know they didn't take the body because they didn't yet believe. But they think the Jewish leaders are going to come after us next. And they've seen the power of the Jewish leaders. They'd seen the power of the Roman government. And they were not yet ready to die. They weren't ready to believe. They were scared to death. And it's into that moment, in the middle of their fear, locked in a room, not yet believing, in the dark of the room, that Mary comes in with the news, but they're not yet ready to believe. But in that moment, Jesus came in, and he stood among them, and he said, peace, peace be with you. Now, Jesus is standing in the room with them, right? And you have to ask yourself the question, Mary didn't believe. Why do these guys not believe? Well, for them, it wasn't that they were mourning. It was that they were just afraid. And I would dare say that that's why some of you don't believe. You're afraid. Some of you are high schoolers, and you're afraid of what your friends would think if you really believed and lived like you believe. You're afraid of that. You don't know what they're going to do to you, what they're going to say about you, what relationships you're going to have to sacrifice to make that kind of surrender to God, so you don't believe really. Some of you are businessmen in the room, and you knew it would be a complete lifestyle change for you to really believe and live like you believe. It changed the deals you make. It changed the way you spend your money. It would change the things that you do with your family, the way that you plan your family calendar. You're afraid, and so you don't believe. You lock yourself in the room of your fear. And into that room, with the locked door, Jesus wants to come step into the room of your life in the middle of your fear. And what does he say? Verse 20 tells us what he wants to do. He said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they, what? When they saw the Lord. The pattern's building. As they see Jesus in the middle of their fear, all their fear turns around, because you don't see the one that you thought was dead at the hands of the Roman government and the people and the religious leaders and now be afraid of the same people you were afraid of. Why? Because he overcame the fear. As some of you right now, Jesus wants to step into the room with you, and he wants to show you the validity of the physical reality of the resurrection, because it says something about what you're most afraid of. He wants to be the answer to your fear. Why does John write these things? Because he knows that there's people that are afraid in the room today, and you won't believe in the resurrection because of your fear. And so we get the story, not in the backdrop of a church service with everybody looking pretty. We get the worst possible moment on the people that should have been the most familiar and been ready to believe, and they didn't. And Jesus steps in and he shows himself to them. Now, some of you are afraid, but that's not the end of the story, because some of you are not afraid. Some of you are not mourning, and you don't have this big grief loss story. Some of you, quite honestly, the reason that you don't believe is you've got questions. You got questions. And fortunately for you, the next part of the story is for you. The story is the next guy, and he didn't happen to be there. His name is Thomas. He was one of the disciples. If you skip down to verse 24, now Thomas, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. And so the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." They saw him. They told somebody. He didn't believe. I heard about it. Don't believe. Seen it. Believe. They tell him. He doesn't believe. Why does he not believe? Well, he gets a bad rap. Most people, you could tell me what his moniker, anybody know his nickname? Doubting Thomas, right? I'm glad that, aren't you glad that God doesn't stick a nickname on your worst sin, right? I don't know what that was, so I'm not going to try to figure out what that is for you, what your nickname would be, but I don't want to know mine, right? So we all know him as Thomas, but here's what I'd like to say in his defense at the progression of this passage, is he is not unlike anyone else in the passage. He is just the climax of the passage. Mary Magdalene doubted. All the disciples doubted. And now Thomas, we get a real crystal clear picture of what I think is the last obstacle for most of us in the room today. Maybe not grief for you. It might not be a fear for you. You're ready to believe. But there's some reasons that you don't. For him, he needs some evidence. He says to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and I put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." I appreciate Thomas's honesty. I always appreciate when I sit down with someone and they're honest about why they don't believe. I'd much rather have that than somebody act like they believe and they don't. But I can really get with Thomas mentally, because he's like me, I think. I'm very analytical. I lie awake at night sometimes thinking of questions. And so some of you, the reason you don't believe is because you're analytical. And you've got logical questions for why don't you believe. Some of you, you don't believe in the parting of the Red Sea. You're like, that's not possible. You think about a God who would have sent a flood and wiped out everybody except for one family and some animals, and you're like, really? I got to believe that. Some of you have questions about dinosaurs, right? Some of you had no questions until I just started making this list. But here's the deal. In the response to all those questions, and there are a lot of questions, what you see here is that when you're honest about the questions you have, and you're not just questioning just to raise questions, but you're questioning to seek evidence that God, through the physical reality of the resurrection, wants to be the answer to your deepest questions. I'll have this conversation with multiple people. I've had it through the years, and people say, well, I've got reasons I don't believe. I've got everything I listed to you. I've got more. I've got this question here and this question there, and if you can answer these questions. And so they come to me. This is what I get to do for a living, try to convince people of all the stuff in the Bible's true, right? That's a hard job. But I always respond in one way. I always say, okay, how many questions do you need answered before you believe? How many do you want me to answer? You got two? You got five? You got 10? You've got 100? Because we always put qualifications on God of why we will or we will not believe. But underneath it all, I feel like there's a subversive, there's a distraction from you. There's a reason that you really don't believe. And it's really not the little question you're asking. You know that if you really believed in the physical resurrection of Jesus Christ, that you might could find the answers to all the other stuff. But there's a reason you don't want yet to believe. And so for Thomas, he put the qualification on. He says, listen, I'm going to be honest with you. I hear what you say you saw, but I got to see it myself. And I can appreciate that about him because that's me. I need evidence. And so what does God do? He does what he does with a lot of us when you ask the question. He waits. Watch what happens in the next verse. A week later, some of you ask questions of God and you're saying, listen, there's not a God because he doesn't answer my questions on my timetable. Thomas says, I'm not going to believe until I see. And then a week later, Jesus decides that he's going to come back and talk to Thomas, and they're in the house again. They're still locked up, right, not knowing what to do. And Thomas was now with them, and the doors were locked. And Jesus came, and he stood among them, and he said, peace be with you. Sounds familiar. But now Thomas is in the room. And then he says this in verse 27. Then he says to Thomas, put your finger here, see my hand, reach out your hand, and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. He says, see. I want you to see something. Now, it's always been puzzling to me how Mary didn't recognize Jesus at first, how disciples didn't recognize. You see in other Gospels, and they're on the road to Emmaus, that there's some disciples walking with him. They don't recognize him, right? He's in a glorified body. But somehow in a glorified body, he left some scars. Like, was there not a plastic surgeon or a laser around somewhere? Or, you know, your God, couldn't you just fix that if you fixed all the rest of it? Why scars? And I got to thinking, I've got some scars. You're like, damn, please don't show us your scars, right? But I've got one on my arm right here, a pretty big one. I've got one right here where I about cut my thumb in half one time, and it's sewed together. I've got one over here where I pushed my hand through a window once, had to get that sewn up. And what I know about every one of these scars, and all the ones I'm not going to tell you about, is I can remember a specific moment, a specific event when it happened. See, a scar is evidence of an event. I can tell you where I was standing when I got the scar on my arm. I can even tell you what I was wearing. I can tell you the scene. I can remember everything about it. The scar points to an event. And so what Jesus does for them is a great gift, and what he does for us is a great gift, is he points to a scar to point to an event to say, it really happened. It's really me. He points them to a physical reality so that it doesn't just stay in a physical reality, but it becomes a personal reality. And you see how these things are building. Mary in her fear, Mary in her grief, disciples in her fear, and now Thomas with his questions. God says, look. And God says, see. What's his response? His response is really simple. Thomas said to him, my Lord and my God. If you ever wonder what a sinner's prayer sounds like, that's probably the closest thing you'll get. You're not going to find it in some track I give you or something like that. I made all that up. What you see here is probably as close as you get. If you want to pray and receive Christ, this is where it starts. You see, because what he doesn't say in response to this is what a lot of you might say if I said, hey, tell me who Jesus is. Some of you might know enough to say, well, he's the Lord. And you'd be right, but that's not his response. I would say to you, who's Jesus? And you would say, well, he is God. I know enough about that to know that answer. Got it. Been to Sunday school. Got it. Check. But that's not what he says. What he says is he is my Lord and he's my God. And that makes all the difference in the world. Because this is physical reality turned into personal reality for him. He says that you, Jesus, are who you said you are. And you are Lord. You are boss. That means whatever you say goes. That means that whatever decision I have now looks through the filter of the resurrection. That means that now that you're in the room with me, I believe you're my Lord and you're my God. And some of you, you've answered the question, who is Jesus, by saying he's the Lord, he is the God, but you've never personally said he's my Lord and he's my God. And you can recite the story, you can recite scriptures and verses, you're familiar with it, you can spout it off, but you don't believe because he's not your Lord. He's not your God. You see, it doesn't change who he is to make that change. It just changes your experience of who he is. And so when I ask you to draw a circle around yourself, do you really believe? I wasn't talking about whether or not you believe Jesus was the Son of God or whether or not he was the Lord. I was asking you, is he your Lord? Is he your God? Well, how does Jesus respond? Well, he says, because you've seen me, you have believed. And then he changes the pattern. See, believe. He says, blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed. Why did John write these things? Because he wanted to build to the moment when Jesus said this. The pattern has been, prove it. Let me see it. Then I'll believe. But Jesus knew that in 2017, some of you would be sitting here and you can't see him right now. And he wants you to know that if you believe in the physical reality of the resurrection, the personal reality can be just as true as if he's in the room with you today. Blessed are you in 2017 if you believe, having not seen. I can't present to you Jesus resurrected here, but I can present to him through the eyes of the apostles and through the evidence in my life. And so God wants to bless you with that. He wants to invite you in to that. And where we began in John chapter 20, verse 30, is where we end. I'm going to have the band go ahead and get ready, and we're going to finish up with this. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not recorded in this book, but these are written that you may what? Believe. That Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. But I didn't give you the full end of the story. What he said at the end of that verse, in verse 31, is that by believing, you may have life in his name. What hangs in the balance with this decision to believe? Life and death. Life and death. A lot is riding on whether or not you believe in the physical reality of the resurrection. It's become a personal reality. Whether you've said my God and my Lord and my God, or you haven't personally. What hangs in the balance? Life and death. Eternal death or eternal life. That's what hangs in the balance. And a lot of you have made a lot of important decisions in your life for a lot less when the stakes were a lot lower. Some of you have changed jobs because it provided a little bit more money. Some of you have sold a house, moved across town, or moved to another city because you wanted to be in a different school district. You made a decision. You changed things based on what you saw was a benefit for your life. Some of you have stopped doing some things for your health and begun doing some things for your health. Some of you have done that. Why? Because you want life. We make a lot of decisions in this life, and we make those decisions for a lot less things, though important, a lot less. And so today, at the end of this time together, I want to invite you to make a decision when the stakes are the highest for you, when the backdrop perhaps is darkness for you, when you've got questions, when you're afraid. I want to invite you to believe today. In the seat that you're sitting in, you probably had to move it to sit down. I want you to take that card out that was there. I want every single person in the room to take it out. If you'll take that thing out and you'll flip it over, it says believe on one side, I've decided. And on the other side of that, there's four things on there. The first of those things simply says this, is I want to begin a relationship with Jesus Christ. And my first invitation to you is simply this, those of you that need to say my Lord and my God today, is I want you to check that box. If you've been in a time where you've been familiar with Jesus, but you've not put your faith and trust in Him, you haven't believed, if you want to begin that step of following Him, when you say, my Lord and my God, I want you to check that. Just check that box. Put your name, put your phone number on there, if you will. Check that box. And we're going to help you. We're going to pray with you and help you find the answers you're looking for to begin that relationship with Jesus. For some of you, there's other things you need to do. Perhaps baptism. You've been coming to church, you've been saved, believer, but you've been kind of stopped short of being obedient with baptism, the public display of an inner reality for you, that personal reality. You haven't made it public. You want to check that. You might want to check that. I'd like to be baptized. For some of you, you've just been stagnant in your faith for a long time. There was a time when you're growing, perhaps, or maybe you've never grown. You don't really know how to even begin reading the Bible, but you want to. You're never around other people that can feed into your life. And you say, I love some info on how I can grow in my faith. Simple thing, right? We want to help you with that, so check that box. For some of you, you want to get attached to a church family. You know you can't do this alone. You can't follow Jesus alone. You weren't meant to. And so you want more information about church and how you get plugged into church and how you can become a part of the church. I want you to check that. Some of you, you hear all the time and you say, well, none of those apply. Well, the very least you can do for us is allow us to pray for you. And so what I'm going to ask you to do, if none of those apply to you, is to fill in a prayer request so that we can pray for you. Our staff's going to get together, our deacons are going to get together, our group leaders get together over time, and we pray for these things, and we want to pray for you. But I want every single person in just a few minutes, I'm not going to ask you to come lay it on an altar or nail it to a cross or throw a stick in the fire or anything like that. I'm just going to ask you to make the decision to check a box. And you've made a lot bigger decisions, I mean a lot littler decisions for a whole lot less to do a simple thing like that. Because it would make no sense to come and celebrate the resurrection at an Easter service and to walk out and it have never been a personal reality to you. And so this is a safe place to do that. So what I want to do now, Ben's going to come out, we're going to sing, because there's only life in one name, Jesus. And Jesus, creator of everything, sitting in His glory, made a decision to get involved. Not because He had to, not because He needed to, not because He needs us, because He desires us. It speaks of His great love mixed with His great righteousness and holiness. He comes to give His life for us. He desires us. And I don't fathom, I don't pretend to understand why He does that, but He does it. That's why He sent Jesus, and that's why He wrote these things. So if you would, as the band comes out, would you bow your head and close your eyes? And would you pray with me? I asked you early in the service to draw a circle around yourself. And so that circle's still there, hopefully. And would you just now begin inside that circle? Would you speak to God? Maybe you've never prayed before or haven't prayed in a long time. But first, I want to ask you to do this. If you've never put your belief and faith in Jesus Christ, I want to ask you to say four simple words. My Lord and my God. It couldn't be simpler to say, such a significant moment. If you need to accept Jesus, will you just simply say to Jesus right now what Thomas said, my Lord and my God? And what you mean by that, you mean that you're going to follow Him no matter what. You're not going to be perfect. You're not going to clean yourself up. You're going to come to Him as you are, with your struggles, with your sin, with your shame, and then He's going to exchange your sin for His righteousness, my Lord and my God. For some of you in here, you've been drifting for some time. You believe all that stuff, but you haven't been living that way. You've been living, pursuing other things, and you need to make a change. You need to repent. And so would you just say to God today, I repent of that. I want to follow You too as my Lord and my God. Show me how. Show me how. A lot of other decisions in the room, a lot of other prayers, but I want to pray for all of us. And I want to thank Jesus for giving us a name that if whoever calls upon the name of Jesus shall be saved. Let's thank Him for that name together. Heavenly Father, we do thank You. We thank You today that You sent Jesus. You told us these stories. You proved the validity of Your physical resurrection. And my prayer is that that will become a personal reality to every single person in the room today so that we could walk out and we could share the story of life. We can bring light into darkness. We thank You that You sent Jesus for us, that He died on the cross, and that we celebrate the fact that He was resurrected again today, as we do every day, every Sunday, every moment of every day, that that is where life is found. We thank you for the name of Jesus, that when we call upon that name, you promise to save us, God. There's no other name to call on in our darkness, in our weakness, in our grief, in our fear, in our questions. We call out to you, Jesus. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.